Hey guys, Dan the Man with Ralston Acres Christmas Tree Farm. You know, we've talked about a lot of things in setting up our Christmas tree farm so far, but one thing we haven't talked about is buildings. So let's dive right on into that today. One of the things that is important in setting up the Christmas tree farm in questions that you might get is what kind of infrastructure do I need? What kind of buildings do I need? Do I just need a tent? Do I need a building? How big? How small? Well, that's up to you, but one of the things that I would suggest is looking into either some type of prefab building that you can bring onto your farm, or do like what we did when we built one. Now this is not the original, but this is not the one we work out of now. But that is something to consider. And again, I go back to the same thing that we talked about earlier. You don't have to build the biggest thing. You don't have to have everything that you want all at once. Baby steps when you're growing your tree farm. But this building here, this is a 16 by 20. Building that we have. This is primarily used for storage now. Before, we had used this building for actually to sell our Christmas tree products out of. We actually end up the first year, I think we even had our checkout in here. And then what we did after that is we moved to next door. We had this building here for our wreath making and a small gift shop area. And then we had our office was a prefab building that we brought in, maybe a 10 by 12 or 12 by 12, something like that, that we could work out of. And we even started selling some concessions out of it at one time. But as the years went by, and you're gonna find this out if you continue Christmas tree farming, every year gets a little bit bigger and a little bit better. Well, we got to the point to where we were selling about 1,000 trees a year, and we just outgrew this particular arrangement. And so what we did is we ended up going up on the hill, which we're gonna take you up that way, and we ended up building a barn, a bigger barn. Again, though, you don't have to do that to start with. That doesn't have to be done in the beginning. Baby steps. It took us about 9 years or so before we got big enough to build the barn, but I'm so glad we did, because without that, we couldn't have kept up with our tree sales. So let's take just a second and let's go up to the barn and let's see what it looks like. Okay, guys, as you can see behind me, this is our red barn, we call it. This is where all the hub of our operation is. We've got our office, our concession stand, our wreath shop, and plenty of places to store our pre-cut trees. And that's also serves as a walkthrough for the backfields where our choose and cut lots are. So I just wanted you to see that this particular building, I'm gonna step back just a second. This particular building is about a 72 wide and about a 60 feet long, barn. The biggest part, the interior part here, was about 40 by 60, but then we turned around and added these wings, and so this is has done real well with our handling of traffic, and I think we can put about 144 people inside the barn. That's what the fire marshal says. And we have exit signs, and I would say this: when you're doing your buildings and things in your barn and your on your farm, make sure you check with your county zoning commission or planning commission or building permit or the fire marshal, just somebody there with the county, so they can sort of guide you into what particular things they're going to require of you. It might be that they require exit signs. I know when we was building this barn here, they said, well, you're a business. I said, well, yes, for about 6 weeks a year, but we're a barn the rest of the time. Well, then you're a barn. Well, you were also a business. So, you know, a lot of counties don't quite know how to handle a circumstance like a Christmas tree farm that has a business operation for a short period of time during the winter. There's a lot of things about this that they handle as a business, and there's a lot of things that they handle as a farm. So sort of look, each county could be a little different. I know there are some counties in Tennessee that I have been talking to some farmers up there, and they are very restrictive on what you can put up. But then there are some counties that are not as restrictive. I think the more rural counties that you have, the less restrictions that you're going to find as far as building on agricultural property. Also, you want to make sure that it's zoned properly, obviously. If your county has zoning, it needs to be zoned agriculture, or at least some form of agriculture. But check with your county office and see exactly what hoops you have to jump through, or what requirements they might have to have before you dive into building a lot of buildings. I know that when I was talking in the earlier part of the video about the small building that we built, that was no problem. But then as time went on, we brought in this other building on sleds. It was movable, and that was still no problem. But then when we built this building here, okay, more restrictions, more regulations had come into play, and there was about maybe a 8 to 9 year difference in time period. So we had some things we had to consider when we was building this building here. A lot of it's, where do you have water in it? Do you have bathroom facilities? That's a whole new gambit of things to look at. And also you want to look at handicap accessible as much as you can. So all these things are considerations when you start building and getting bigger. I've seen farms that start out with nothing but a tent, because it's only going to be, you know, for about 5-6 weeks, maybe, if not even that, if you're small. And then you gradually work into some bigger buildings. Okay, just real quick, I wanted to show you a little bit about our pole barn, and I'm going to sort of step out of the picture and just sort of point some things. This barn was originally built to handle when I had beef cattle. It's about a 30 by 30, and we put another shed on the side of it. We store a lot of our mowers and tractors and wagons and things that we just don't want to get wet. So I wanted to show that to you. You don't necessarily have to have that, but it does come in handy if you do have access to one on your farm. Before we left the barn entirely, I wanted to switch gears and come on the inside so that you could see some of the planting of things that you might want to put inside your barn. Again, this is the big barn, okay? This isn't the small stuff that you would start with, but it sort of has the same ideas behind it. One of the things that we want to have is an area for your office. Remember I said we built had a pre-built small, say 12 by 12 or 10 by 10 prefab building that we put up. You could go out and buy those, so you could go online and find them. But we had one of those, and we built an office inside that, basically, is what we used it for. We had our cashier, we had maybe even had a refrigerator in there, just a little something to double as an office while we were trying to wait on customers. This is the office area that we have now. We're just seeing one corner of it. The sunlight's coming in, and I can't get a good video. But this is sort of what we used last year. You can see the cashier area was here and here, and you could look out, and the customers would be out in that area coming to you. But you know, every Christmas tree farm needs to have a sort of a command central. Sort of a place where you know, any office work or any cashier, any kind of checking out is going to be. So right here is where we would use it inside our barn. But again, you don't have to be this big. It can just be a small 12 by 12 room or prefab building that you want to bring in. But that is important, that you do have a space for your customers to pay for their trees and wreaths and their things they buy at your farm. This is the area of our big barn that we use for our gift shop. You know, again, you don't have to have a gift shop when you first start. That's something you grow into with time. But for some of you that's been selling trees for a few years, just wanted an additional idea as to what to do with some space, a gift shop is a profitable area to use inside your barn. We have shelves that we built. All this is out of rough sawn lumber. It's nothing fancy. Everything's rustic, And you know, one of the reasons that we keep it that way is because it sort of goes with the farm, rustic, this is the way I remember barns type theme. So we do have that, and of course this is empty right now. We've already packed our stuff up for the year and moved it into storage. But as you can see, it is a important part of the wing, if you will, of our big barn. And I keep emphasizing so much, you don't have to have this when you first start out. But it is something that you can plan on growing into as you add space to your infrastructure. So I'm gonna go on to our wreath shop now and let you take a look at what we do there. Okay, we're standing in the area that we like to call our wreath area, wreath shop. People, customers, you can't see it right now, they come through the door right here and they come here. We've got wreaths that will be all over this back wall, and I can show you some of that in just a second. But these are the wreath tables. We actually make some of our wreaths. We get some greenery from the bottom of some of the trees that we shear or that we prepare for customers for the stands. We also import some of the greenery from either a Noble fur provider or a Fraser fur provider, and they make very good wreaths. And sometimes we incorporate all the different varieties into wreaths that will look good and last a long time in a person's home. But we can make them right here, and that making wreaths is something that when customers come to the field, and I apologize again for the sound, but when customers come to the field, they want the experience again. I go with that word, experience. And so when they come in here, the wreath is an add-on. It's something besides the tree that they're interested in. And they like seeing it handmade. Some of the wreaths that we do will actually be made as the customer waits on them, or maybe they'll put an order in and say, hey, I'd like to come back this afternoon and pick my wreath up, and we'll have it made for them. But it actually goes on. We have two wreath tables, one there, and we got another table in the middle that we use for just miscellaneous items. But the wreath tables are important. And that might be something that you might want to look at as you get started, maybe a year or two, in making some wreaths. Go to some wreath making classes, look online, there's some good ones. The Tennessee Christmas Tree Growers Association always has some good educational material on making wreaths. That is something that, again, I consider as an add-on. Some people say, well, you know, I can't have a tree in my home. I'm a little allergic to it or whatever, but I'd like to have a wreath on my door or, you know, something along that line. Well, and that's what I tell people, you know, oh, I have an artificial tree at home and that's all I can do because I'm out of town a lot. Well, okay, how about buying a wreath, a real wreath? And that sort of, depending on the variety you buy of wreath, that can give you some fragrance of the Christmas season that you might want to use in your home, either on a door or as a display somewhere in your home, a centerpiece on your dining room table. But they're made right here. And that again is an add-on. So what people can do once they come into this, and again, traffic flow is what I was thinking about. They can come in this door here, they make a wreath or get a wreath made right here. And as you can see, they can walk right into our gift shop, which is on the other end that we just shot a video of earlier. So right straight through there would be our gift shop. So it's sort of a stream or a pattern that they can use to go in, and they go out the door and then to the office and pay for their purchases. So that's the wreath shop. Now we're gonna look at some other areas that I think that are important in planning your Christmas tree farm. One thing that I forgot a few minutes ago when I was talking to you about the buildings that you have, maybe some of y'all can catch this, water. You know, wherever you're gonna see setting up, whether it be a tent, whether it be your small building, or whether it be pole barn, whether it be the big barn like we got right here, water is something that you're going to need to have close by as far as a source of water. So right here is one of our waters we've got at each corner of our barn. On this side, there's another one down there. I don't know if you can see that or not, all the way down there. We also have one at the other corner of the barn. And of course, we have water in our concession stand. So water is an important part. Now, whether you install a restroom for a public restroom or not, that's simply up to you. We've elected not to do that just yet because of the expense. And in our neck of the woods, wintertime can be, you know, a light winter where we're not getting a lot of real cold weather. And then it could be a winter like we've had a couple of years where it would get down to zero and stay there for a week or so. So we've elected not to do the restroom. Some farms have, and that's a great thing to have. It's very convenient. We bring in portable restrooms, we're only going to rent them for the time period that we're open. And it works out very well also. Just remember to talk to the people who you're renting it from. There is sort of a rule of thumb as to the number of restrooms you have versus the number of people that you would expect on the farm at a given time. And you also want to make sure that one of your restrooms is at least handicap accessible. So I just wanted to make sure that you got the other resources we have besides electricity. Yes, you want electricity if you're going to build a building, but don't forget the water.
As you can see, there's a lot of things that go into planning a Christmas tree farm. Infrastructure is just one more important part. Take your time. Don't try to do everything at once. Remember, it is a marathon, not a sprint. But thank you for watching us. I do appreciate that very much. If you haven't already subscribed, please hit the subscribe button below. That helps us and is of no cost to you. And if you'd like to leave us a comment and tell us about some things that you want to see, in particular on some future videos, we'll be more than glad to read them and try to incorporate that into our video channel. Thank you very much. Have a good day, and we'll see you next time on Farming Around the Christmas Trees.